Your host, Pastor Randy Mitchell.
Welcome, and thank you for joining us today. Listen, great response to last week's program. We introduced to you a young preacher by the name of Cody Hsu, and had a great response last week. In fact, several people, I believe, called and inquired about having him in to preach. And a good young man, good preacher, very serious about God. And we appreciate your response to the program last week. Now, last week I mentioned that we need you to help us with Salt and Light by sharing the broadcast. And there was a handful of people that did. And that meant that the truth and the things that we talked about last week, that it reached more people. And so I just want to encourage you to keep that up. We're not trying to make a name for ourselves. We just want to get the truth of God's Word to as many people as possible. And so we don't promote ourselves, but you can help us out by sharing our broadcast and getting that out to more and more people. Well, today I'm going solo today because I've got a topic that is very dear to my heart, because shortly after I got right with the Lord, I went through a major crisis. And it wasn't one of those crises that just lasts for a couple weeks. It literally lasted over a year. And it was an ongoing crisis in my heart and in my mind. And so what I want to talk to you about is the subject of blessed assurance. Now, many of you, if you're saved and you've been around church for any length of time, no doubt you have come across the old hymn written by literally my favorite hymn writer of all time, and that is Fanny Crosby. And she wrote a hymn entitled Blessed Assurance. And just the first verse says, "Blessed assurance, Jesus is my..." Notice I'm not singing it because I don't want to lose you as a listener, but "Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood." And that is just a sample of a tremendous hymn. One of my favorite hymns, has a sweet, precious melody. And many, many times while I'm praying or thinking about the Lord, this hymn is just echoing in my heart and in my mind. And I'm so thankful for faithful Christians like Fanny Crosby, who gave us that particular hymn. So we're talking about blessed assurance, and I want to just kind of give a little disclaimer. We're not talking about eternal security here. Now, I believe that the Bible teaches eternal security. Not everybody sees it that way. I understand, but I am convinced by the truth of the Bible that as believers, we have eternal security. Now, I don't believe that everybody that claims to be saved is saved and going to heaven, but I do believe that the people that are genuinely, truly born again, that we have eternal security, and we're going to go to heaven one way or another. But I'm not talking about eternal security today. I'm talking about blessed assurance. And I want to give you a verse that is really an important verse of Scripture, but it's often overlooked by people because it's not one of those verses that that creates a positive emotional response. In fact, this is a heavy verse. It's really, really heavy. It's very very intense. It's very serious. And let me read it to you. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse number 5. Paul says to the Christians at Corinth, listen to this. He says, "Examine yourselves, whether ye be in the faith." Now, being in the faith means being saved, or if you're not in the faith, then you're not saved. "Examine yourselves, whether ye be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves, how that Jesus Christ is in you?" And that's what salvation is. Salvation isn't a denomination. It's not an affiliation. It's not even specifically an experience. It is a person, and that person is Jesus Christ. "Know ye not how that Jesus Christ is in you, except ye be reprobates?" Of course, reprobates means rejected and so forth. And so the Bible says we are supposed to examine ourselves. We're supposed to prove our own selves whether or not we be in the faith. I am certain, I mean, just from the 30 plus years of ministerial experience, I am certain that most of you listeners have probably never really considered this Bible admonition that I need to look in the mirror from time to time, and I need to examine my own heart, my own life, and be able to prove that, yes, I am saved and I'm on my way to heaven. You know, we have all kinds of medical tests. And how often have I heard testimonies about people that go in for a routine physical? They felt fine. They thought that everything is just fine. They go in for a routine physical only to find out once there is an exam, once there's blood work done or an X-ray or a CAT scan, that something is revealed that they have a life-threatening illness. How many times have I seen people who just had a little pain or a little something that they were concerned about, and they went in and they got an exam, they got blood work done, only to find out that it wasn't anything serious, and that put their mind at ease? Folks, that's an prime example of what God is telling us that we need to do from time to time. Now, I don't believe that this soul-searching and heart examination is something that we should do every day of our life. That's why blessed assurance is such a wonderful truth, to be able to have that peace, to be able to live our day-to-day life with that assurance that Jesus is ours and that if we were to die, we'd go to heaven. And so I don't think that this is something that we should do every day, but I do believe that from time to time that a believer, someone who professes to be saved, we should take a look at our own life and examine ourselves whether or not we are saved. You know, the Bible teaches, in fact, Jesus said this. This is red letters in my Bible. Jesus said that not everyone that thinks they are saved are saved. Listen to what our Lord said in Matthew 7, verse number 21. He said, "Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you, depart from me, ye that work iniquity." Now, I understand that the context of this is the kingdom of heaven, and not necessarily our salvation, but the truth is still absolutely relevant to us today, that there are many people that think that they're okay with God because of, and Jesus said, you know, they referred to him as Lord, Lord. They said, we prophesied in your name. We preached, we prayed. Even these people said they've cast out devils. They have seen God do some mighty miraculous things in their lives. Wonderful works. And Jesus said, depart from me, I never knew you. And in this passage of scripture, the Lord is saying that only the people that do the will of my Father, which is in heaven, only them will enter into the kingdom of heaven. And so it's very important that we understand and acknowledge that not everyone that thinks that they're okay with God are indeed okay with God. That's why we need to take a look at our heart and our life and examine ourselves. Now, on the flip side of that, and I speak this from experience, that not everybody that doubts their salvation is lost. And I'll say more about that here in just a moment. You see, there are all kinds of mental, psychological, and spiritual things that we struggle with, because when we're saved, even though we get a new nature, we still have the old nature with us. It's not eradicated, and it won't be until the rapture takes place. And when that takes place, we'll get a resurrected body. We'll get a mind, and we'll get everything about us will be completely brand new and like Jesus Christ. But until then, we have Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit and a new nature living inside of us, but we also have the old nature, that sinful nature that we inherited from Adam. And that's why saved people always have this conflict inside, something trying to pull them toward sin, something trying to pull them toward righteousness and toward God. And that struggle, if you have that struggle that goes on, and sometimes it's intense, then that really is, it's not the only indicator of salvation, but it's a pretty strong one according to the scripture. There's a thing such as false guilt. This is what John the Apostle said in 1 John 3, verse number 20. He said, "For if our heart condemn us, God is greater than our heart and knoweth all things." So, folks, there's a possibility that our heart could be condemning us, and it's not over something that's true, or at least not God's perspective, just because we're feeling an intense guilt, that doesn't mean absolutely that that came from the Holy Spirit. If our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart and knoweth all things. And then in verse 21, John said, "Beloved, if our heart condemns us not, then have we confidence toward God." What is that confidence toward God? That is blessed assurance. When our heart is not condemning us. Listen, for a believer to be living for God and striving in their life to follow the Lord and to live for Him and to have that false guilt, that's going to take away your joy. And the Bible says the joy of the Lord is our strength. God wants us to have the joy of assurance. Now, if I had to choose between going through my life having a perceived joy, thinking that I'm saved, only to die and find out that I'm lost and I'm in hell, I would much rather doubt my salvation and be miserable my whole life as a saved person and die and wake up in heaven and be pleasantly surprised. That would be way better. But I'll tell you what's even better than everything is to actually be saved on our way to heaven and to know it and to have that confidence and that joy of knowing that Jesus Christ is mine. And what could be better than to live a life of blessed assurance? So not only is there false guilt, but there's also something that often is overlooked in modern Christianity. And that is the fact that there is a spirit world around us. There's an invisible world, and folks, the devil, Satan, is very real. And the Bible says that he has angels. And these angels, we often in our culture refer to them as demons. The Bible refers to them as devils, plural. And they are fallen angels that followed Lucifer when he rebelled against God. And they do his bidding. And the Bible says that there are principalities and powers of the air. And what these principalities, what these devils do is they wreak havoc and they oppose everything that God is for. They oppose righteousness. They oppose truth. And listen, the devil is the father of lies. He was a liar from the beginning. And these spirits, these devils, are seducing spirits, but they are deceivers. And what they're trying to do is they're trying to affect your mind. They're trying to affect your emotions. I have had times, literally, in my Christian life where, as far as I knew, I was right with God. I didn't have unconfessed sin in my life. My heart was right. I'm walking with the Lord. Everything just seems great, and all of a sudden, this sense of oppression and guilt and just feeling like God has forsaken me, just despair, and these emotions just overwhelm. Now, when the first time that these happened in my Christian life, I thought, what is going on? Did God leave me? And I found the answers to my experience in the Scripture. I found out that I probably just had an encounter and spiritual warfare with the principalities and powers of the air. And Paul said that we don't wrestle against flesh and blood. We wrestle against principalities and powers, against the rulers of darkness, of these wickedness, the wickedness of high places. And so Satan, through his devils, can certainly affect our emotion. In Revelation 12, verse number 10, when Satan is cast down, they rejoice and they say, "For the accuser of our brethren is cast down." Have you ever read in the Bible where the Bible in 1 John refers to Jesus Christ as our advocate, also as our propitiation? You see, in heaven, in the invisible realm, Satan is accusing God's people to God. He's trying to get God to turn against us. And then in our realm, he's trying to get us to turn against God. He's trying to play both sides against the middle. He doesn't fight fair, and he doesn't fight with ethics. There's no rules with him. Whatever he has to do to turn God against man or man against God, he's gonna pull out every tool in his toolbox. And the Bible says he is the accuser of the brethren. And as he is accusing us before God, he also will give us that false guilt and that satanic oppression. And the Bible makes that very, very clear. Now, as I continue here and shift gears in our lesson this morning, I wanted to point this out. And this is my very, very strong observation. And I've counseled people through the years. I've been able to use what I've been through to help others that were struggling with assurance. I've also dealt with people that, you know, they have a time in their life where they prayed a prayer, but they have, you know, not only do they not have assurance, but they don't have any evidence of salvation. They, you know, the only thing they can point to if you ask them if they're saved is they'll point to a prayer that they prayed as a 9-year-old kid in Sunday school or a 7-year-old kid in vacation Bible school. But no other evidence, no chastisement, no conviction. They just live their life however they want to and they think that they're fine. Folks, the truth of the matter is that most people should be doubting their salvation because they're lost. But the people who feel the most confident that they're okay with God are the people that aren't. And on the flip side, the people that are truly trying to follow the Lord or have had victory in their life in the past, they're the ones that struggle with assurance. And it's because of the spiritual battle that we face. And some of it is because a saved person has experienced something that many lost people have not experienced. And in the religious world, we call it conviction. The word conviction has the root word of convince. And when preachers talk about conviction, what they're talking about is when a person is basically morally and spiritually awakened, their conscience is awakened. Now, we come into this world with a conscience. Man's born with a conscience. That's part of being made in the image of God. But the human conscience is not the best guide. You know, in Pinocchio, I think it was it Jiminy Cricket that said, follow your heart or follow your conscience? Those are not very good things to follow, because sometimes our conscience and our feelings will go contrary to the truth of God's word. But the reality of it is that there are people who think they're saved that never doubt it, that should. There are people that are saved and they struggle greatly trying to get that blessed assurance in their life. They've experienced conviction, the time when God brought their conscience to life. Not just a little minor conflict, but something that we realize. When I got right with the Lord, if someone would have told me, Randy, you are a sinner, I wouldn't have answered with, yeah, I know, isn't everybody? I wouldn't have answered it that way. I would have been painfully aware that I'm a sinner. Now, in the whole scheme of things, I probably was not the worst sinner in the world. There are people a whole lot more wicked than I was if you just look at all of the facts. But when I got right with the Lord, I didn't even care what everybody else was. I felt like that I was the worst sinner that ever walked on this planet, just like when Paul referred to himself as the chief of sinners. When conviction sets in, we don't see ourselves as a sinner like everybody else. We only see that I am a sinner in the eyes of a holy God. I'm in trouble. And so a believer has at some point in their life experienced that conviction. And sometimes in our immaturity, our lack of understanding, or even our lack of faith, when Satan brings that false guilt, we will assume, we will follow that deception, that counterfeit, and we'll assume that that's the Holy Spirit of God, when in reality, it's Satan's counterfeit trying to discourage us and to keep us from having that blessed assurance so that we have the strength in order to follow and serve the Lord. And so what are the root causes of struggling with assurance of salvation? On my list here, I have one that is, I believe, a big one, and that is childhood conversions. If you were saved as a real small child, I was saved as a 5-year-old boy. And I don't remember the details about it. I remember enough to believe that I did get saved then, but I struggled with assurance because I didn't have the experience and the memories. And I hear other people's testimonies, how that they got saved and the emotional experience, and boy, they never ever doubted it. And I think, well, that's not me. And so childhood conversions can cause doubting of salvation. Comparing our testimony with other people's testimonies, that can cause a loss of assurance. And then there's also unethical preachers. Folks, I'm convinced that too many preachers today, or too many soul winners, they use emotional manipulation to get a decision rather than just giving the simple truth of the gospel and letting the Holy Spirit of God do the work. And when we are emotionally manipulated into something, then that will not give us the emotional assurance that we need in the future. And the bottom line is this: people who doubt their salvation, that are truly saved, they have something inherent in them in which they are putting too much confidence in their feelings and not enough confidence in the Word of God. And that's where I was. When I got right with the Lord after being backslidden, I remember saying to myself, wow, if I wasn't saved before, I know I'm saved now. And it was from that moment on that it's like the devil asked me this question. Well, if you don't know when you were saved, then maybe you're not saved. And that fear started just growing, and just the Satan was embellishing it and magnifying it in my heart. And my problem all along is I enjoyed the feeling when I got right with the Lord of God being so real and so powerful. And I was so overjoyed with the experience. But God had to wean me from my own emotions, and God had to get my confidence and my faith turned from my experience and my feelings, and to put that confidence back where it truly belonged, simply on the Word of God. And folks, I had to make a decision. I said, God, and I tried to get saved many, many times, and finally I had to come to the conclusion, God, if you send me to hell, well, it's what I deserve to begin with. You could send me to hell and you'd still be good. But Lord, if I go to hell, I'm going to go to hell trusting the blood of Jesus Christ and the cross of Calvary. And you know what? When I finally surrendered to the Word of God, I found that peace and that assurance. And you know what? The same thing will work for you. Thank you for being with us. God bless you. We appreciate you taking the time to join us at Salt and Light. It is our desire that you experience the joy of following Jesus Christ. He loves you, and He died on the cross for your sins. He will give you hope, peace, and eternal life if you will repent of your sins and trust Him as your Savior. You may see yourself as a good person, but you will never be good enough to deserve heaven. You may see yourself as bad, but you can never be too bad for Jesus to forgive you. You can call upon Him to save you this very moment. If you are a born-again Christian, we want to encourage you to obey Christ's command and be salt and light to those around you. We encourage you to find a Bible-believing church that does not compromise or water down the Bible. Get involved serving the Lord. If you have a Bible question or a particular issue you would like us to discuss on Salt and Light, visit our website at templebaptistnc.com. Click on the Salt and Light link. Once again, that's templebaptistnc.com. May the Lord bless you. We hope you'll join us again next week.
When you get in your